Hi everyone, welcome to lesson 3. This time we are going to talk about the lexicon. The lexicon is the set of all words in a language that are registered in a dictionary. An entry is each word included in it. Sometimes a word might have two different entries because there are basic differences in meaning attached to that single word. Each word provides information in a dictionary about meaning, pronunciation, word class, derivation, inflection, and some historical information about the development of the word. As a part of the lexicon, we have what are called lexical verbs. Lexical verbs are all the verbs in the language except auxiliary verbs. So, verbs are divided into groups, lexical verbs and auxiliary verbs. The difference is that lexical verbs express meaning and auxiliary verbs are only function words to express negation, to express questions, and so forth. Here, it is important to talk about what is complement configuration. Complement configuration refers to the elements that follow a lexical verb. The types of complements that each lexical verb might take. For instance, if we say, he bought a house, the complement of the verb buy is a house. So, we can say that the complement configuration of the verb buy is verb plus MP. In this case, the complement configuration has a noun which is functioning as the direct object of the verb buy. Now, in the second example, it says, she's smart. Smart is an adjective, so we can say that the complement configuration for this verb is verb be plus an adjectival phrase. Then, Mike works in this company. In this clause, the complement configuration for the verb work is a prepositional phrase in this company. And finally, he suggested that you should come to the meeting. Here, pay attention. The complement configuration for the verb suggest is a full clause. You should come to the meeting. Therefore, complement configuration can vary from a simple word, a phrase, or a full clause. Clauses are structures formed basically by a subject and a predicate. The subject is always a noun phrase, and the predicate is always a verb phrase. So we can say that syntactically a clause has two constituents, a noun phrase and a verb phrase. And according to the function or semantically, a clause has two constituents, a subject and a predicate. The characteristics of clauses can be determined as this. First, a clause has a finite verb. A finite verb can be a tense verb. It can be in the present, past, or future, or also a verb plus an auxiliary. In the second place, the verb takes one or more complements. Remember in the first class, a verb can take a complement and adjunct. Number three, in this characteristic, we have to refer to mood. A clause might express the indicative, interrogative, or imperative modes. Indicative, when we are asserting something, when we are making a statement, affirmative or negative clause. Interrogative, when we are asking a question, and imperative, when we are issuing a command. Finally, we have a more complex structure. This is the sentence. A sentence, grammatically defined, might have two or more clauses. But in syntax, grammarians state that English, as other languages, has three types of sentences. Simple sentence, which we know as a clause, compound sentences, and complex sentences. Going back to clauses, we might say that we have two basic types of clauses, main and subordinate. Main clauses express full meaning. On the other hand, subordinate clauses must be attached to a main clause to express a complete meaning. Subordinate clauses are adverbial clauses, relative clauses, and complement clauses. We will talk about them later. Sentences, on the other hand, are compound, which are formed by two or more independent clauses joined by a conjunction. For instance, Marta cooks lunch, Sam sets the table. Here we have two independent clauses because each one has full meaning. When we join them together using the conjunction AND, we have a compound sentence. Marta cooks lunch and Sam sets the table. Complex sentences are formed by a main clause and one or more subordinate clauses. Look at the example. Sam believed that his house was haunted. Sam believed is the main clause. That his house was haunted is the subordinate clause. In this case, we have a complement clause. Subordinate clauses can be complement clauses, which occur in noun slots as complements of verbs. For instance, Mike regretted that he has visited Paula. Here, the verb regret has a complement clause following it, that he has visited Paula. The complement clause is completing the meaning of the verb regret. Mike regretted his actions. Here, the complement is just a noun phrase, his actions. His actions complete the meaning of the verb regret. His actions is a direct object. Relative clauses are another type of subordinate clause. Relative clauses modify nouns. The book which you gave Laura is interesting. Pay attention that the relative clause which you gave Laura is complementing the noun book because it is describing what book specifically was given to Laura. The book that you gave to Laura is interesting. Pay attention to these two clauses. The only difference in these two clauses is the complementizer. In the first sentence, we have the complementizer which, And in the second sentence, we have the complementizer that. This is a way to recognize that a clause, a subordinate clause, is a relative one. It's a relative clause. Only relative clauses can switch the complementizer that with a WH word. Can be which, can be who. Because complement clauses use only the complementizer that. And relative clauses use different complementizers. For instance, the boy who is at the door is very smart. Who is at the door is completing or specifying which boy, completing the meaning of the noun boy. Here also, we know that it is a relative clause because we can change who for that. And we can say the boy that is at the door is very smart. Adverbial clauses is the last type of subordinate clauses that we have in English. Adverbial clauses modify other clauses. Adverbial clauses are different from adverbs. Adverbs are defined as the words that modify verbs, adverbs, and adjectives. Adverbial clauses only modify other clauses, but they are treated as adjuncts, which means that they can be omitted without changing the meaning of the sentence. We have different types of adverbial clauses. Reason, for instance, I went home because I was tired. We recognize the subordinate clause because I was tired because of the subordinating conjunction. The subordinating conjunction because indicates that there is a reason after it. Another type of adverbial clause is the one that expresses time. She was in Rome when the accident happened. When is a WH word indicating time, and it is fronting the subordinate clause, the accident happened. Manner, Sam changes his plans easily. The adverbial easily indicates manner. I can help you if you need it. The word if indicates condition. And finally, even though Sam was very sad, he did not cry. Even though is indicating concession. He did not cry, not cried, sorry. We can recognize two forms, two ways in structures, form and function. Form refers to the way words are put together to form larger structures and as clauses. And function refers to what the clause does within a sentence. For instance, complement clauses modify verbs and nouns. That's the function. Relative clauses modify nouns. And adverbial clauses modify other clauses. Thank you very much. God bless you.